Mission Audio presents The Aging Brain, Proven Steps to Prevent Dementia and Sharpen Your Mind by Timothy R. Jennings, M.D., narrated by Sean Renett. Author's note, this book proposes specific lifestyle interventions to improve health, slow aging, and reduce the risk of late-onset Alzheimer's disease, AD. This book is not intended to provide steps to address other types of dementia, such as frontotemporal dementia, Lewy body dementia, spongiform disorders, and so on. You should consult a qualified medical professional before initiating these interventions or any other fitness regimen. The interventions in this book are intended to be implemented in consultation with your doctor, and this is especially so if you suffer from any medical condition. Introduction. It's personal. This book is personal, not simply because my heart has been touched by the numerous patients I have treated over the last 26 years, many of whom suffered from dementia, nor because my wife and I are in our middle 50s and acutely aware of the difficulties of aging, but because over the last several years, I have watched my wife's mother slowly being ravaged by Alzheimer's disease. I have felt the heartache, the frustration, and the sadness as she has become more feeble, less aware, and less capable. I know the utter frustration of being helpless as a loved one who had been so reliable, so strong, and such a bastion of courage and support to everyone else slowly loses the ability to care for her most basic needs. I have seen the hurt on my wife's face as she recognized each newly lost ability and found her mother becoming ever less present. And my heart is torn every time I see the fear in my wife's eyes as she realizes her risk of dementia is increased because her mother has it. Yes, this book is personal. In writing it, I have sought not only good scientific evidence, but also usable information to be put into practical action that will promote better health and slow aging, and help us in the pursuit of our goal to prevent the development of late-onset Alzheimer's disease, even in those who are already at higher risk for developing it, and in those who are already showing early signs of impairment. It's been said that beautiful young people are accidents of nature, but beautiful old people are works of art. I dedicate this book to my wife, Christy, who is both a beautiful accident of nature and the most beautiful work of art I have ever known. Christy, I hope this book will remove your fear and give you confidence to know that rather than slowly fading away, you can grow more beautiful every day. And to the listener, I invite you to share in this vision, to use the information in this book to not only live long, but also live well and grow more beautiful every day. Part 1. History and Aging. Chapter 1. The Problem of Aging. We all do it. And yet the wiser mind mourns less for what age takes away than what it leaves behind. William Wordsworth, The Fountain, A Conversation, in Lyrical Ballads, 1800. It was painful to watch, agonizing really. Anger, frustration, helplessness, mixed with sadness, heartache, loss, and of course denial. This can't be happening. But sadly it was. The features were the same, blue eyes, teeth yellowed from years of use, but her historically warm and friendly smile wasn't warm, wasn't friendly. Not anymore. Like so much of her, it was empty, just a shell. She was a wasting, shriveling, slowly decaying shell. "Hello, Mom," was met with a confused look. Her formerly thick brunette hair, always kept, was now thinning, snow white and disheveled. How could this be happening? Alzheimer's disease, the name given to this destroyer of worlds, the thief that neuron by neuron slowly steals life away. Like a picture slowly fading, like the last beams of sunlight growing ever dimmer, this insidious disease robs a person not only of ability but also of their very selves. In the 21st century, Alzheimer's disease is perhaps the most frightening diagnosis a person can receive. But it has not always been this way. In fact, dementias like Alzheimer's are a relatively new problem for humanity. Just 50 years ago, cancer was the most dreaded diagnosis for many. While cancer remains a terrible problem, for those over 50, the threat of losing oneself as the brain slowly deteriorates is even more terrifying. The rise of dementias as a problem in human history is a result of ever-improving healthcare and the fact that people are living longer. Prior to the last 100 years, few lived long enough to develop dementia. Throughout history, there have always been health scares, but dementia wasn't one of them. During the 14th century, the Black Death, bubonic plague, swept across Europe, killing one-third of the population. People lived in terror of contracting this mysterious disease. No one understood the cause, let alone how to treat it. Religious leaders proclaimed the ghastly destruction was the wrath of an offended god. Yet it was merely a bacterial infection, Yersinia pestis, carried by fleas. Today, the disease occurs infrequently, and if antibiotics are given, it rarely results in death. The greatest killers throughout most of human history have been infections, from either disease or wounds. Prior to modern antibiotics and sanitation, life expectancy was short. Before the 20th century, essentially every family lost children in death. Before 1900, only 39% of men and 43% of women lived to be 65 years of age. But by 1997, 77% of men and 86% of women lived to the age of 65. At the turn of the 20th century, 1900, the top three causes of death, accounting for 30% of all deaths, were from infections: pneumonia and influenza, tuberculosis and gastrointestinal infections, diarrhea and enteritis. But by 1990, with the advent of water treatment, food inspections, antibiotics, modern dentistry, and childhood vaccination, this had markedly changed. No longer were large segments of the populace dying from infections. By 1990, the top three killers, accounting for 60% of all deaths, were heart disease, cancer, and stroke. Today's top killers are as follows: cardiovascular disease, 28.2%, cancer, 22.2%, stroke, 6.6%, chronic lung disease, 6.2%, Alzheimer's disease, 4.2%, diabetes, 2.9%, flu and pneumonia, 2.6%, accidental injury, 2.2%. Strikingly, the top five causes of death are all a result of people living longer. They are no longer dying at a young age from infections. America, as a populace, is aging, and with an aging population comes increased numbers of age-related diseases. In 1950, there were 12 million people over the age of 65, accounting for 8% of the population. By 2002, this increased to 12%, or 36 million people. And according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, by 2030, there will be 71 million people in the United States over the age of 65. The number of the very old, those over 85, is also increasing. From 1950 to 2002, there has been an eightfold increase in the number of people ages 85 and older. It is projected that by 2020, there will be 7 million people over the age of 85, and by 2040, that number will double to 14 million. For the young, the idea of living longer is all about length of years. But as we grow older, the quality of life begins to overshadow mere age. This is evidenced by the growing right to die trend, the principle that individuals have the right to end their lives, usually because their quality of life has become so poor it is tantamount to sustained torture. In the United States, three state legislatures, Oregon, Washington, and Vermont, have passed laws permitting physician-assisted suicide. And in 2009, Montana's Supreme Court ruled physician-assisted suicide legal. In California in 2015, the governor signed a physician-assisted suicide law into effect during a special session of the legislature after the law failed to pass in regular session. Its full implementation is pending at the time of the writing of this book. Pain, suffering, and disability undermine quality of life and must be considered in any discussion of aging. In 2011, there were more than 40 million people ages 65 and older in the United States, and more than 14.5 million, 36.6% of them, suffered with some type of disability. More than 9 million, 23.6%, had impairments in their ability to walk. Nearly 6.5 million, 16.2%, could not live independently. More than 6 million, 15%, had impaired hearing. Nearly 3.8 million, 9.4%, were disabled due to cognitive impairment. More than 3.5 million, 8.9%, could no longer provide basic self-care. And more than 2.6 million, 6.8%, were visually disabled. People don't simply want to live longer. They want to live better, healthier, happier, and fuller lives. The greater question today is not how do we live longer, but how do we live better? How do we retain our vitality, health, independence, and autonomy? How do we slow the ravages of time? The good news is not only can we live longer, but we can also live better, healthier, and more vibrant lives. By making the right choices, we can maintain our independence, vitality, and most importantly, our mental acuity. Dementias, such as Alzheimer's disease, are not inevitable. Disability is not predestined. Yes, we can live longer, and we can live better. In this book, we will explore aging. I'll differentiate normal aging from pathological aging. I will identify activities that accelerate aging and increase the risk of both physical disability and dementia. But I'll also provide specific actions a person can take to slow the aging process and protect our brains and bodies from deterioration in order to maintain our independence, autonomy, and abilities as we age. At the end of each chapter will be lists of learning points or action steps or both for you to implement that are designed to reduce your risk of dementia. Because of individual differences from person to person, not every intervention is applicable to every person. For instance, a person with nut allergies would not benefit from adding nuts to their diet, whereas those without the allergy would. Select those elements from the action steps that are applicable to your life and build an action plan that will improve your vitality and brain health and keep your mind sharp. Science and medicine have reduced the risk of dying young. Now it is up to us to decide how we will age. Will we make purposeful choices to maximize health and maintain our abilities? My wish for you is that you will use the information in this book not only to live longer, but also to live more vibrantly with each passing year. Learning points. 1. Modern science has reduced the risk of dying young. 2. Dementia is a problem of living longer. 3. We can make choices to reduce the risk of dementia even while living longer. Chapter 2. Developing a Healthy Brain. It Needs a Healthy Body. A comfortable old age is the reward of a well-spent youth. Instead of its bringing sad and melancholy prospects of decay, it should give us hopes of eternal youth in a better world. Ray Palmer, 1808-87, American clergyman and poet. When we talk about aging, what do we mean? Are we speaking merely of chronologically growing older, or do we mean something else? While a common dictionary definition of aging is the length of time something or someone lives or exists, in this book, when we speak of aging, we are not referring merely to the number of years one lives, but also to the slow decline in vitality, health, and ability that occurs as we age. Most people would be thrilled to live eternally if they knew they would retain their health, vitality, strength, and abilities. Aging, in the context of this book, refers to functional aging, the slow decline in vitality and ability. While time passes at a constant rate for every person, not every person ages at the same rate. Life experiences and the choices we make affect our passage through time and can slow or accelerate our aging, the gradual loss of vitality and ability. In this book, we will identify multiple factors that accelerate aging and interventions we can take to slow it down. While we will discover there are many factors involved, this does not need to be overwhelming. Consider for a moment those factors that contribute to your car either breaking down or being disabled by an accident. These factors are analogous to what can happen in our bodies. Poor construction, for example, ignition switch problems that contribute to accidents, genetic or epigenetic vulnerabilities to aging. Poor condition, lack of exercise, or failure to maintain healthy nutrition. Defective or worn-out brakes, impaired ability to calm down or slow down. Bald tires, overly emotional individuals who are not grounded in reality or who easily slip and slide as the emotional weather changes. Distractions, for example, texting, changing the radio station, other people in the vehicle. Caught up in entertainment or alcohol and drug addictions, such that one doesn't attend to one's health. Poor visibility, lack of education, insight, or understanding. Wet, snowy, or icy conditions, toxins, pollution, and industrial exposures that accelerate aging. Purposeful sabotage, physical and emotional abuse, war, and crime. Sleeping at the wheel. Failure to listen and learn, ignoring healthy guidance when presented. Just as each factor contributes to the risk of your car breaking down or being wrecked, so too each of the corresponding bodily factors contributes to our risk of disability as we age. Addressing one or more of the factors related to our cars does not guarantee we will avoid a breakdown or accident, nor does having one or more of these problems make accidents or breakdowns a certainty. However, the more of these problems that exist simultaneously, the greater is the likelihood that an accident or breakdown will occur. Every factor that we address reduces risk. Likewise, when it comes to aging, we will explore many factors that accelerate aging. The more of these factors we address, the more vitality we retain, and the greater we are able to slow the aging process and reduce our risk of dementia. A healthy brain requires a healthy body. The first principle to maintaining a youthful brain is to maintain a healthy body. Why is it important to maintain physical health if one wants a healthy brain? Because the primary purpose of every organ system of the body is to serve the brain. The lungs breathe and the heart beats in order to provide oxygen and nutrients to the brain. The legs move the brain from place to place while the arms allow the brain to interact with the world. The primary function of our eyes and ears is to provide data input to the brain. The gastrointestinal GI system absorbs nutrients to provide energy and raw materials for the operation of the entire body, but especially for the brain. While the brain weighs only 3 pounds, which is about 1 to 2% of the body weight, it utilizes 20% of the body's energy. The GI system also protects the brain from potential toxins. Whatever we eat and drink is absorbed into the blood, but before the blood carries what has been ingested to the brain, it first passes through the liver. This is so the liver can identify and neutralize any toxins and poisons to prevent them from impairing or damaging the brain. For instance, the liver has enzymes that detoxify alcohol. In order to get intoxicated, a person has to drink enough alcohol to overwhelm the liver's ability to detoxify it. Ingesting small amounts of alcohol will not affect the brain because the liver will detoxify it so that it will never reach the brain. When we understand this reality, we realize that whatever undermines the health of the body will not necessarily undermine the health and functioning of the brain. Not surprisingly, studies have shown that major illnesses such as anemia, diabetes mellitus, and cardiovascular disease all increase the risk of developing dementia later in life. What is less commonly known is that failing to care for one's teeth increases the risk of developing dementia. In fact, research has found that those with the fewest teeth had the highest risk of prevalence and incidence of dementia. So a simple action to reduce dementia risk is to practice good oral hygiene, daily brushing, flossing, and regular dental checkups, all focused on keeping your teeth and gums healthy. It is impossible to keep our brains healthy without keeping our bodies healthy. Design law. One idea we must understand, and that is crucial for being able to make healthy life choices, is the idea of living in harmony with design law. What is design law? Simply stated, design laws are those parameters, protocols, and principles on which life is constructed to operate. In this context, they are commonly known as the laws of health. Why don't we put water in the gas tanks of our cars? It is so much cheaper than gasoline. Think of all the money we could save. Will the manufacturer inflict punishment if we fail to follow the written instructions in the owner's manual? Why don't we do it? The reason is quite simple. The vehicle was not designed to run on water, and therefore it will break down. Design laws are those laws that govern the operation of the fabric of reality itself, such as the law of gravity, the laws of thermodynamics, physics, and health. Human beings cannot create space, time, matter, energy, or life. But thinking in this way is counter to how most human organizations function. Human beings make up rules in an attempt to bring order, what we call laws, and then enforce those rules with threats of punishment. Thinking that is counter to design laws is so automatic that many people fail to realize it just doesn't work when it comes to healthful living. Adolescents often think that what makes tobacco or marijuana smoking wrong is that it's illegal. If the laws change, then smoking these toxins will be okay. They fail to understand the difference between human laws and design laws. Humans can pass laws to make cigarettes and marijuana legal, but we can never pass laws to make them healthy. Regardless of whether smoking is legal, tobacco smokers are violating the laws of health and cannot escape the damaging results. Many patients live like adolescents, thinking very little of design laws, eating and drinking anything they want, and then expecting the doctor to provide a pill to resolve the damage. Life and health simply do not work this way. We will come back to the idea of design law many times in this book. But for now, simply understand this. It is not possible to be healthy outside the laws of health. Understanding design law, especially how it applies to our physical and mental health, is critical to slowing the aging process and maximizing our vitality and wellness. Take a moment to review your own life and lifestyle and answer this question. Am I currently engaging in any practice or activity that I know is unhealthy for me? If the answer is yes, consider why. What is the reason you are doing it? And consider the price you are paying, not just the monetary price, but more importantly, the price to your health, wellness, and vitality. If you want to slow the aging process, examine your life and choose to eliminate practices that you already know are unhealthy. I am speaking here of ongoing practices, the routine, habitual, repetitive engagement in activities that are unhealthy, not the occasional indulgence. Having a Thanksgiving feast once a year will not have a significant negative health effect if throughout the rest of the year one eats reasonably. However, a healthy meal once a year or once a month won't provide any significant health benefits if the daily routine is a junk food diet. The brain. The brain is an amazing organ composed of over 100 billion neurons and over 1 trillion supporting cells. Each neuron can have up to 10,000 connections to other neurons, and it is these interconnections that are critical to intelligence and information processing. But what determines whether a person has a complex, interconnected brain capable of critical reasoning, problem solving, and real wisdom, or a brain that prunes, deletes, or simply fails to develop its circuitry? The most critical time for brain growth is during fetal development and early childhood. During fetal development, the brain is in production mode, cranking out the raw materials and weaving them together to form the various foundational structures and networks of the brain. At certain points in development, tens of thousands of brain cells are being produced per second, and then, after production, all these billions of cells have to assemble and organize in their appropriate locations in order to form the networks needed for normal functioning. Therefore, fetal development is a very vulnerable time period for brain development. Recently, news reports have documented the devastating impact the Zika virus has on fetal brain development. What appears to be happening is that the Zika virus hijacks the brain's factory cells, the cells that produce the billions of other cells, and instead of producing brain cells, these factory cells crank out more Zika virus. Thus, fetuses infected with Zika are born with severely small brains and heads. But many other factors can also negatively impact normal fetal brain development: alcohol, tobacco, environmental toxins, malnutrition of the mother, and infections. So the first factor in determining whether a person develops a brain with complex interconnections is a healthy experience in the womb. While it is obviously too late for those of us listening to this book to change our pre-birth experiences, it is not too late to share this information with our children and grandchildren and thereby provide benefit to future generations. Regardless of what happened before birth, once a person is born into the world, the brain remains pliable and changeable. In fact, the first 7 to 8 years of childhood are critical in establishing networks that form a foundation for future learning and behavior. When a child is born into the world, the brain has millions more neurons than that brain will have by age 8. The first 8 years of life are a time of rapid brain wiring, reshaping, and developing. Ideas, abilities, concepts, and beliefs are being wired into the brain. What determines which circuits develop and which do not? Whether those neural circuits are utilized or not, which is a function of another design law, the law of exertion. The law of exertion is simply this: if you want something to get stronger, you must exercise it. If you want strong muscles, you must exercise them. If you want strong musical ability, you must practice your instrument. If you want strong math skills, you must work problems. When exercised, the brain fires neurons that correspond to the specific activity. The repeated firing of these neurons results in not only the retention of the corresponding neurons, but also the production of new neurons and the recruitment of other neurons, and the circuitry for that ability expands. The brain structure changes based on the choices we make in thinking, acting, and experiencing. But if you don't use it, you lose it. Persons born blind have been shown to have heightened ability to process other sensory information, greater memory, and greater cognitive processing. Recent brain mapping comparing the brains of individuals born blind with those of persons who were blinded later in life found that the brains of those born without sight had recruited areas of the visual cortex to help process the sensory input of touch, smell, and hearing. The brain is not a static organ. It is highly pliable and in a constant state of flux based on life experience. While the brain continues to rewire and change throughout life, these changes are made more easily during the first 8 years of life. Imagine a blank whiteboard versus one filled with drawings. It is easier to establish a new drawing on a blank board than on one already filled with drawings. To create new images on a board filled with drawings, one has to erase the previous drawings. Likewise, it is easier to learn in childhood when the brain is blank. Once patterns of learning are established, new learning can and does take place, but one often has to unlearn in order to learn new things. Many golfers understand it is easier to learn to correctly swing the club right from the beginning than to try to learn the correct swing after already having established a bad swing. This is a book about aging. Why then are we talking about early childhood? Because it is in early childhood that the foundations for our future lives are set. One of the factors that has been demonstrated to slow brain aging and the risk of dementia is education and mental activity, that is, learning new things. This is a direct function of the law of exertion. Education exercises the brain and results in its development. Those who are educated develop more complex brains and are generally more knowledgeable about how to live healthy lives, thus avoiding many destructive factors that accelerate aging. As a result, they are more resilient and resistant to the ravages of time. And studies have confirmed this. Those with 16 years or more of education can expect to live more than a decade longer than those who did not graduate from high school. In order to stimulate brain pliability, the branching and connection of new circuits and the formulation of new neurons, the brain has a group of proteins that stimulate neuronal production, sprouting, and growth. These are called neurotrophic factors. Think of them as fertilizer for the brain. When these proteins are available, the brain circuits remain healthy and flexible, and new learning is easier. But when these factors are not available, learning becomes more difficult, and the brain will actually wither and shrink. Three known neurotrophins are brain-derived neurotrophic factor, BDNF, a vascular endothelial growth factor, VEGF, and nerve growth factor, NGF. These brain fertilizers are shut down by factors that accelerate aging, such as fear and worry, tobacco, illegal drugs, heavy alcohol use, sedentary lifestyle, mood disorders, unhealthy diet, oxidative stress, and chronic pain. While certain medications have been shown to affect individual neurotrophic factors, only physical exercise turns on all three. The law of exertion. And the benefits of exercise to brain pliability are not restricted to our childhood. In fact, persons over age 65 who exercise, walk as little as 15 minutes per day, have been shown to experience 2% growth in the brain's primary memory cortex, hippocampus, which effectively reversed 2 years of aging. Childhood, with its rapid brain changes, is a period when the brain is extremely pliable and changeable. The activities, education, nutrition, and religious practices experienced in childhood will impact the structural development of the brain. Adverse events will negatively affect brain development because they increase activity and stress pathways, which cause alterations in gene expression and result in individuals with increased risk of physical and mental health problems later in life, thereby accelerating aging and increasing the risk of an early death. We cannot go back and undo our childhoods, but because the brain remains changeable throughout our entire lives, we can make decisions today that will protect our brains, slow the aging process, and reduce our risk of dementia. The body and brain are intimately connected, and brain health cannot be maintained without maintaining the health of the body. The brain is truly an amazing organ, and throughout this book, we will document how you can keep your brain in peak working condition. Learning points. 1. Aging is the slow loss of vitality and ability. 2. Life operates on design laws, laws of health. Understanding and living in harmony with these design parameters is essential for maintaining healthy functioning. Deviation from these parameters is damaging and accelerates aging and loss of vitality and ability. 3. One of the design laws is the law of exertion. If you want something to get stronger, you must exercise it. If you don't use it, you will lose it. 4. Every organ system of the body has, as its primary purpose, to serve the brain. Thus, healthy brain functioning requires maintaining as optimal physical health as possible. 5. The human brain is in a constant state of flux, changing itself based on the choices we make and the experiences we encounter. We therefore have the ability to choose experiences and actions that will slow the aging process and promote healthy brain development and function. Action plan. Things to do. 1. Practice good oral hygiene. Brush, floss, and get regular dental checkups. 2. Establish a relationship with a primary care physician and get annual physical exams. Work with your doctor to prevent and/or treat any physical health problems. 3. Inventory your life and identify practices you know are unhealthy, and then make changes that move you toward healthier lifestyle practices. We will examine many specific examples in later chapters. 4. Share with family and friends who are planning on having children the importance of a healthy pregnancy and early childhood to the development of a healthy brain. 5. Engage in lifelong learning. Contemplate new ideas. Challenge yourself to see issues from a different vantage point. Join discussion groups. Take art lessons. Join a Bible study. The list of possibilities is endless. Engage your mind regularly. 6. Begin walking 20 minutes each day. We will explore physical exercise in more detail in a later chapter. Chapter 3. Epigenetics and Aging. The Impact from Our Ancestors. People will not look forward to posterity who never look backward to their ancestors. Edmund Burke, Reflections on the Revolution in France, 1790. While most of this book will explore various factors that impact aging, over which we have significant influence, the complete story of aging begins before we are even conceived. In this chapter, we will explore those influences originating in our immediate ancestors that affect gene expression and impact aging in us. While we can do nothing to change history and the genetic material with which we were born, we can, through healthy choices, not only alter our genetic expression and thus impact our own health, but also pass those changes down to our children, grandchildren, and great-great-grandchildren, impacting their health as well. Every cell of our body that contains a nucleus contains the same genetic information, deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA, with the exception of individuals with extremely rare disorders. Yet bone cells are different from skin cells, which are different from muscle cells, which are different from the cells in our eyes that transform light into electrical energy so we can see, or the cells in our tongues that transform chemical signals into electrical ones so we can taste. Yes, all the cells in a person's body have the same DNA, but the DNA is expressed differently, resulting in wide diversity in the shape, structure, and function of the various types of tissues throughout the body. Our DNA is like a vast library of information with instructions on how to build everything the body needs. But each cell type opens only the books, genes, in the library that contain the information those cells need to do their job. Thus, cells in the stomach do not access the information on how to make bone, and cells in the brain don't access the information on how to make blood cells, and so on. All the information is there in the library, chromosomes in the nucleus of each cell. But cells open only the books, genes, that have the information they need. This means there must be some instructions directing the cells on which books, genes, to access and use. It was in 1957 that researcher Conrad Waddington first made this observation and hypothesized that there must be some set of instructions that sits above the DNA, instructing the DNA on which genes to turn on, express, and which genes to turn off, not express. He coined the term epigenetics. Epi means above, as in epidermis, the top layer of your skin. And genetics refers to the DNA. So epigenetics means the chemical instructions that direct the access and usage of the information contained within the DNA. DNA, though incredibly small, is the massively huge database of information in which the instructions on how to build every part of our bodies are stored. Imagine a zipper, two rows of teeth that interlock. Now, imagine that zipper is very long, miles long. It is zipped, then sections are wrapped around spools, and those spools are packed tightly together. This would be similar to how our DNA is stored. Each tooth on the zipper represents a DNA molecule. The molecules are organized in a way to create coded information from which our bodies are built. Imagine the DNA molecules are letters of the alphabet, and they are organized to spell words that are put together in sentences containing building instructions for the body. Just as there are two sides to a zipper, there are two strands of DNA that zip together, then wrap around histone molecules, which are packed tightly together to form our chromosomes. But in order to read the code, the zipper must unpack, unwind, and unzip. DNA expression is modified by either enhancing or impairing the unpacking, unwinding, and unzipping. There are various molecules that can attach to the DNA and influence its expression at these various points. For instance, methyl groups can attach directly to the DNA strand, and when this happens, the DNA in that region is locked down. This would be like getting a shirt tail caught in your zipper. The zipper cannot unzip. Methyl groups, therefore, when attached to the DNA strand, shut down the expression of the DNA in the region where they attach. Conversely, any gene that had methyl groups removed would experience an increase in expression. Environmental factors, life experiences, and even thoughts we think can impact how our DNA is being expressed. And when we have children, we not only pass along our DNA sequences, but also the epigenetic instructions specifying which genes are turned on and which genes are shut down. Smoking, famine, and grandchildren. Researchers in Sweden discovered that men who began smoking before age 11 had altered genes carried on their Y chromosome that caused their grandsons to have greater likelihood of obesity than if they had not smoked. And individuals who in their childhood, before puberty, experienced a short food supply had altered DNA expression such that the men conferred greater mortality risk to their grandsons and the women conferred greater mortality risk to their granddaughters. This means if you were a man and your grandfather, or if a woman and your grandmother experienced a significant famine in their childhood, then you began life with a greater risk of dying young than if your grandparent had a normal food supply. Low-calorie diet during pregnancy. Another provocative study examined children born in the Netherlands during World War II when there was a severe food shortage and whose mothers averaged about 500 calories of food intake per day. These children grew up to have higher rates of obesity, diabetes mellitus type 2, and other metabolic problems such as hypercholesterolemia than their siblings of the same parents who were born when normal amounts of food were available. Genetic examination found that the metabolically compromised individuals had 5% fewer methyl caps on one specific gene, IGF2. This would result in an increased expression of this specific gene. The researchers concluded that this gene is involved in food metabolism, and the increased expression resulted in these individuals extracting more energy from food than their siblings. What appears to have happened is that when these individuals were in utero during the food shortage, a signal was sent to the developing fetus that there were not many nutritional sources in the world. This low energy input resulted in fewer methyl caps attached to gene IGF2, and these individuals were born genetically programmed to get more energy out of food. But the war ended, and food supply normalized, and with normal food intake, these individuals experienced greater rates of obesity, diabetes, and other metabolic problems, all of which, as we will see in later chapters, accelerate aging and increase the risk of dementia and early demise. Though we cannot alter the conditions of our birth, we can choose to alter our dietary patterns to conform to our individual ability to extract energy from food and thereby avoid or resolve obesity, diabetes, and hypercholesterolemia, slow our aging, and reduce our risk of dementia. Smoking, pregnancy, and epigenetics. People have known for several decades that smoking during pregnancy is damaging to the developing fetus and increases the risk of smaller babies, learning and behavior problems, sudden infant death syndrome, and mental illness. But in 2016, researchers discovered that smoking while pregnant has much more devastating effects on the genetic expression of the child than imagined. Smoking while pregnant epigenetically alters more than 6,000 genes. And nearly 3,000 of these alterations persist into later life. Some of these altered genes have been implicated in cleft palate, asthma, and contributing to various cancers, including lung, colorectal, and liver. At least one study found that girls who were exposed to tobacco smoke in the womb were 2 to 3 times more likely to become nicotine addicted if exposed to tobacco later in life than girls not exposed to tobacco smoke in utero. This means that mothers who smoked while pregnant altered the reward pathways in the brains of their daughters, making them more vulnerable to nicotine addiction later in life. And as I will document later in this book, tobacco use accelerates aging and contributes to increased risk of dementia. Alcohol, pregnancy, and epigenetics. Likewise, we have known for generations that heavy alcohol consumption while pregnant increases the risk of all types of health problems, from fetal alcohol syndrome with multiple organ defects to increasing risks of mental illness. Many of these problems are a result of epigenetic modification and accelerate aging later in life. But what if a woman drank only one alcoholic beverage per week while pregnant? Would such a small quantity of alcohol have an impact on her unborn child? The answer appears to be yes. Children born to women who drank one alcoholic beverage per week had smaller heads, were shorter, and had more behavior and emotional problems later in life than those whose mothers did not drink. Again, these effects occur through epigenetic changes, and as we will see in later chapters, unresolved emotional stress accelerates the aging process. If you find the taste of alcohol particularly enjoyable, perhaps your mother drank while pregnant with you. Animal research has documented that if a mother drank alcohol while pregnant, epigenetic modifications occurred in the genes of her offspring that code for taste, and her children would experience that alcohol tastes better than if she had not drank while pregnant. As we will discover in later chapters, heavy alcohol use accelerates aging and increases risk of dementia. Air pollution, pregnancy, and epigenetics. Dr. Bradley Peterson and his fellow researchers discovered that exposure to air pollution while pregnant impacts brain development. They found a dose-dependent effect of the concentration of air pollution on the developing fetal brain that altered white matter tracts in the left hemisphere, resulting in increased risk of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, in the offspring. This means the greater the exposure to polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, the pollution from burning fossil fuels, the greater the damage to the white matter tracts, and the more likely a person will experience ADHD later in life. ADHD impacts the ability to organize, plan, self-restrain, and complete tasks. Those with untreated ADHD have higher rates of substance use problems, more relationship conflicts, and experience greater stress from routine life activities, all of which accelerate aging and increase the risk of dementia. Mothers thinking while pregnant and the fetal brain. Not only do diet, alcohol, tobacco, and pollution impact our genetic expression, but also the mother's thinking patterns and stress levels epigenetically alter gene expression in the developing fetal brain, increasing the risk of depression and anxiety later in life. One study of more than 4,000 mothers and their children who were followed for 18 years found that if the mother had a pattern of pessimistic, negative, and depressive thinking while pregnant, it increased the risk of her child developing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.